Today, we will talk about algorithms for finding regulatory motifs in DNA. And we will start from a game when we will be implanting patterns in random strings. Let's generate 10 random sequences. And then let's take a 15 nucleotide long pattern and insert it at random positions in these 10 sequences. Now, turn your head. I will hide these patterns and tell me where these patterns are. What algorithms should you run to figure out where I have inserted these patterns? And you already probably recognize that if we slightly modify our frequent words problem, we will find the pattern I have inserted. Indeed, you can concatenate all these sequences and find the most frequent word in the resulting concatenate. The implanted pattern will appear 10 times in this concatenate. It is surprisingly frequent, which most likely will mean that this was the pattern that I have inserted. Now, let me change the experiment slightly. Now, instead of the patterns that I implant without any changes, I will insert the same 50 nucleotide long pattern with four random mutations at random positions. And in this case, this pattern forms so-called KD motifs, which is a K-mer that appear in every sequence with at most D mutations. Can you find such a pattern if I hide from you where I inserted it? Do you think that frequent words problem will be able to help us? Well, that's all maybe entertaining, but what biologists think about this game? I think biologists are falling asleep because it's absolutely unclear what this problem has to do with real biological problems. And I will try to show you that this problem is actually about a biological problem of finding regulatory elements in DNA. My next question will be, do we have a clock gene? Think about our daily scheduler and think how our life depends on day and night. In every cell, we probably have to express different proteins depending on what time of the day is it. But who are these molecular timekeepers who tell the cells in our body what is the time right now? How do these molecular timekeepers are able to change gene expression to produce proteins needed at night as opposed to proteins needed in the morning? And another question that is relevant to this, can we find genes responsible for sleep disorder when our circadian clock has problems? Now, we will focus on plants rather than human because for plants, keeping time is a matter of life and death. Just think about photosynthesis, flowering, or frost resistance. If you don't know what is the time, you will be damned if you are a plant. And the question arises, how probably 1,000 plus genes in plants that should follow the circadian clock, who controls them? Who are the molecular managers who tell these genes increase gene expression or decrease gene expression? Here comes a surprise. Just 3 genes in plants are molecular managers that are responsible for orchestrating this circadian behavior. And they are called CCA1, LCY, and TORC1. These genes are regulatory protein, also known as transcription factors. And these genes, to control other genes, to exert control over circadian clock, they bind to short regions, maybe 10 nucleotides, 15 nucleotides, in the upstream regions of the genes. For example, if one of these regulatory proteins want to control a particular circadian genes, it probably have a region within 1,000 nucleotides from the start of the gene where it binds. For example, here is CCA1, one of these 3 regulators, and to exert control over these genes, it has to bind in the upstream region of these genes. But how does CCA1 know where to bind? Probably there are some hidden messages that tell CCA1 bind here. Our goal today is to find this particular hidden message that's shown on this slide where CCA1 binds to. But of course we don't know where these hidden messages are actually hiding in the upstream regions, and today we will learn about algorithms that aim at finding such hidden messages. We will start from formulating the problem. So when we talked about implanting a 15-mer with four random mutations, we figured out that frequent words algorithm wouldn't work to find it because there are no frequent words that appearing without mutations in the resulting strings after implantations. That's why we need to solve a different problem that I call the implanted motif problems. In this problem, you are given a set of strings DNA and an integers k and d, and you need to find all kd motifs in DNA. Now, how should we solve this problem? Should we possibly explore all possible 4 to the power k k-mers and see which of them represent kd motifs? That will take time. That's why let's try something else. Let's try to see whether pairwise comparison, comparing sequences to each other, would help. Think about this. Each sequence is random. The only non-randomness in this sequence is this implanted motifs. And that's why they probably exhibit larger similarity than other regions of random sequences. Thus, my idea, let's find the most close 15 mers, let's say in the first and second sequence, and it will give us an idea on how the implanted pattern looks like. Would it work? Let's figure out whether the pairwise comparison between strings will help us to find the implanted motifs. Well, unfortunately, it won't work, because when we implant a pattern, it has four differences from the original pattern. But we don't have access to the pattern, so there is nothing to compare with. The only things that we have are implanted instances. But every two implanted instances, actually four plus four mutations apart. How can we find them? Since pairwise comparison won't work, maybe the only option we have is just to explore all 4 to the power k possible k-mers. Should we explore all of them? Not necessarily, because if a k-mer is so far away from all k-mers in the strings that we analyze, there is no reason to explore it. It cannot possibly be an implanted pattern. That's why motif enumeration algorithm would work like this. We will start from each k-mer from a sequence, let's call it A. For each such k-mers, let's generate all possible mutations with up to D nucleotides mutated, and for each such mutated k-mer A prime, let's check whether it appears as a kd-mer in the string. That will work, but the question, it will be slow, but definitely will work if k is small, but the question we should ask, would it solve the real biological problem? Unfortunately, it won't work because our model for implanting patterns is not very biological. It doesn't properly reflect biological reality. I would say a little bit messy biological reality, because when biologists generate, let's say, a set of genes that are controlled by circadian clock, they cannot guarantee that all these genes have a particular pattern implanted. Some genes don't have any patterns implanted in the upstream regions. As a result, we need to find out a way to search for motifs, even if some sequences don't have any motifs implanted. And that makes our life a little bit more difficult, and we need to develop scoring for every set of motifs, even in the case when some of the implanted patterns do not look very similar to the canonical motif. And we'll move to the next topic, which is motif finding problem that is more adequately reflect finding regulatory motifs.